It's a book that you read, and with certain situations in the book, you actually have to take a step back, disconnect.
Disconnect.
I'm Princess Irede Abumere, and this is the BBC Africa Book Club. On this episode, we've been reading House of Stone by Novuyo Rosa Tshuma. And with me to review the book is Franklyne Ikediasor. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Princess.
Franklyne is a lover of African literature, and he's also a digital marketing specialist. Right, so let's go straight into it. But before we do, we should give a bit of a background for people who haven't read this.
We should.
So this book, it is about a young man. Well, it's several stories. But it's
several stories. Just
but it's
together.
Driven by a young man called Zemani, who is the narrator of the book. And he's an orphan of the war. And he's trying to find his identity. And in finding his identity, he's trying to reinvent himself as well and create his story.
More or less.
Yeah. What was the reading experience like for you?
Okay. So it was really intense. Mm-hmm. It was so intense. So typically with books, I'd say that I either get a cerebral response or I get a visceral response. So a visceral response, my body's shaking, my heart is racing, I'm sweating, I'm scared. That's a visceral response. A cerebral response, I'm going back and forth, Google, oh, what's this? Oh, I look it up. Not very often do I get books that make me experience it too at the same time, and this did. So I'm scared, I'm shaking, I'm trying not to cry. At the same time, oh, there's Black Jesus, and I go to Google. Oh, this happened, and I go to Google. Yeah. So it was so intense. There were times I literally dropped it, and I'm like, okay, you know what, just chill. But it's such a good story, such a necessary story. So I did see some of the conversations people have had online, and some people were like, oh, it's just following the typical narrative about how to write about Africa. And I've often disagreed with that.
I absolutely disagree with that. With reading this book as well, I had the same experience where I would read. It wasn't a book I could read in one go.
No,
it's not a book you can read in one sitting. It's a book that you read, and with certain situations in the book, you actually have to take a step back. Disconnect.
You're like, okay, did this just happen? And something I really like, which is also something I think Chimamanda did with Half of a Yellow Sun.
Okay.
So there's a war.
Yes.
But the war is a background. So it's about people whose lives were affected by the war. So you're focused on the story, not necessarily on the specifics of the war. Mm-hmm. So that's also something she did. I actually thought it was a man.
No, it's a woman.
Yes, I actually thought it was a man until I did a post on Instagram and then she reposted it. I'm like, oh my God, she did. So that's why I realized she was a woman.
So let's show both our covers. You know that thing of the scene, never judge a book by its cover.
Yeah, but this cover is quite deceptive though.
What do you think of this cover?
This is a bit more, this relates to the story more. This, you think, summer, happy, you know, something really fun.
I also thought, you know, because of the aesthetics, I thought like, you know, I also thought fun, you know.
No, not so. I thought
revelation as well.
Yeah, but look at this. This is like.
That is a nice cover.
Margaritas, orange juice,
but after reading the
butterflies.
Book and knowing about the character, I'm like, no.
Nope. This cover, no, it was so deceptive.
What do you think, you know, this is historical fiction, this is political fiction. What do you think was the author's purpose for writing this book?
And this is one question I used to like to ask, but I've realized I've stopped because I feel like, people always say, oh, what did you set out to achieve when you're writing this book, or why was this book written? And I feel like there shouldn't always be an agenda.
Mm-hmm.
You just want to tell a story.
Yeah.
And it often comes, so people will say, oh, I read this book and there was no moral lesson. Exactly. And we often place a burden on writers to change society, which is something I absolutely disagree with. Mm-hmm. Because it's often writers who have that burden is placed on. Every other person just get to do what they want to do. And I always say that people just tell stories. So this is a story that needed to be told.
Yes, it is.
And I'm sure there are people who survived these things, mm-hmm. who will read this. I'm like, oh my goodness, yes, this was what it was like. And this was something I experienced. So it's very important that these stories are told. And also the people in other parts of the world who pick it up and read and understand, oh, people actually went through this.
Because we're just off of what you said, I did watch a video where the author was saying about how in Zimbabwe, there's a lot of self-censorship. So sometimes people don't even know how to think. So for her, you know, fiction is a way to bring back those lost narratives, to share those lost stories. Just tell them once again.
I agree.
Because I do believe that this gave like a very interesting insight into Zimbabwe, that if you're not a Zimbabwean, you've never lived there, never been there, you know, you hear new, you read news stories, you hear the news, you watch
Absolutely.
The news. But now she takes it to a whole different level. And even though it's fiction, she gives you an insight into what people went through.
Absolutely. And even Zimbabweans who are younger may not know this. And sometimes that's what the war does. So there's sometimes it may not necessarily be PTSD, but there's always a sort of collective agreement to move on.
Let's talk about the main character, Zamani.
My goodness. Oh my goodness.
What can you describe Zamani?
Zamani is very layered.
Yes,
he is very layered. And you know, there's so many parts of him. He's part scared, he's part vulnerable. His part, but everything
part manipulative,
but everything that happened to him was centered around that loss of identity.
Yeah.
So he was trying to center himself, and it made him make horrible choices. Somewhat self-serving, but I will say at the end of the day, we're all literally self-serving. But he made very horrible choices, just in search of validity. Mm-hmm. And if you look at it as well, you see it ties down to he had also lost everything.
Yeah.
You know, he lost his mom literally died in the camp. You know, his father turns out to be Black Jesus. So
the
you also imagine,
yes,
what that is like for you. It was a very complex character to write, and pulled it off.
She did a fantastic job because Zamani is the narrator of this book, and more or less he's living with a family, he's their lodger, and the family has, their son has gone missing. And you know, he's using that opportunity to connect with the family and learn more about them, learn about their history, which then in turn also reveals like the history of the country as well and their experience. But it's just very interesting to see that, you know, his changes through the book, where you see that he's that comforting person. He's there for the family. He's helping them look for the son. But then again,
he's evil.
Was there any other character outside of Zamani that stood out for you?
So, first of all, this book, something I loved about it, so the back characters are also well developed.
Yes, they
are. Which is something a lot of writers don't do.
Yes, they are.
So a lot of writers just focus on one, two, and mm-hmm. but then everybody, like she went into all of the characters, and she probably just
sort of gave you, I feel like with her writing style, she made you feel their emotion.
Yes.
The emotion of even the
exactly. So I really, really loved that. But my favorite character was Thandi. Oh my goodness, I was just, so I mean, while I was reading, I knew Thandi was, something was going to happen to Thandi, so she vanished from the story, and I was just hoping she was going to make it, because she was this revolutionary, she quoted Angela Davis, like, does it get better
she was
than
such
that?
A strong...
She was perfect, which is why when she, I don't know, are we allowed to give spoilers?
I mean, this book was published in, you know, on every episode, we're always talking about, ooh, spoilers, or, but this book was published in 2018. I think we can spoil it a bit.
So when her tummy was sliced open, I threw down the book. Like, it was a reflex. I threw down the book and I screamed. So I was in my bedroom, my friend was around, she was in the living room, and she just ran in. What happened? And then she looked at me and she said, oh, you and your books, and then she just left. I literally threw down the book. I'm like, what just happened? So when that happened, it hit me so hard, because I love the character,
mm-hmm.
and I know people like that. And also, I was not looking at how her life changed, you know, how she got how she had a baby for him, and how
this is for Abed.
How she had a baby for Abed, and how she had to move to the hometown, and then surviving the refugee camp, as it were, and then when they were eventually reunited, and it was sad. And also, you also need to understand all of that also formed Abed. All of that also affected Abed.
Yes, it did.
Into what he became. I mean, he named the other son, Bukosi.
The same name. The same as name his first son.
As his first son. So that was also something. But I really loved Andy.
How would you describe, I mean, we've touched on this quite a bit, but how would you describe the setting of the book? It's set in different times, but how would you describe how?
I think it was beautifully done. It was beautifully done. So it moves. There are certain times I had to, focus and understand, what year is this? Where is this? So it just moves and it's beautifully done. I often say there are quite a lot of writers, not that many storytellers. Few people have the gift of both, who know how to write and who also know how to tell stories. This is someone who knows how to do both, obviously, because the story was just well done. And how we moved from, before the war to during the war to after the war. And we just go back and forth, and it was just well done. So she eases you through, and you can understand how the characters are just fitting into the different pieces, which is just very well done, And in some way, you could say, so some people classify it faction, or they say you use facts to, so some people call it faction. So there's a bit of that, because I actually started Google, like I said, I had a cerebral response. I started looking, I'm like, wait, this actually happened.
Same. I still have in my notes, look this up. Look up this person.
And it's so sad. And I'm looking at how one person, Adichie talks, I quote her a lot. Adichie talked about the danger of a single story, where she always said one person, there's hardly one person that is just one thing. And look at Black Jesus. Could love his son, be this affectionate father, and still throw a little boy into fire and slice open a woman's belly. It's like, how is one person able to be all of those things? But that's also just how human beings are.
I'd say the character that stood out for me, besides Thandi, because she was Thandi wonderful, was Abed. And the reason why is because he appeared to be a complicated character at the start. When his son who went missing, before his son went missing, his son would always ask him, Dad, tell me about your story.
And he would go into such a rage and beat up his son.
But as he's been unraveled in the book and sharing his story,
you
then understand that this is the reason for his complication. This is the reason why he's
just
this
didn't
way.
Want to go back there.
Yeah, he didn't want to.
He didn't want to go back there.
He didn't want to, but he stood out for me. Just you thinking that he's a complicated man, but he's a simple man who is just hurt and holding on to the past.
And he's not hurting other people.
Yeah,
He's beating up his wife and his son, and finding out that his father was actually the white man. He had always believed some...
But he knew his father was the...
Yeah, but he believed, or he would tell people that he had some great-great-grand-aunt who was Indian. he would say that to excuse his light skin. So he would say that. But I think he knew deep down.
He knew, but let's be honest, at that point in time, if we're now looking at facts, it would have been a struggle to fit in.
Yeah.
It would have been a struggle to fit in. What part of the book would you say stood out for you?
So many. There's so many parts that just hit me. But the experience at the camp for Mama Agnes and his mom, that he eventually got Mama Agnes, she just refused to talk about it. And then when she just finally talks about... Now, I'm not sure, but it was Zamani that was narrating it, how he was born. And then the mother was my son is not going to die here. He's going to suffer. And she squeezes him and puts him in a bag and gives to her brother to just escape with him. And it was so sad. It was just so powerful, and I'm just thinking about it. A lot of things were going to my mind. How did the infant survive? An infant, there was no nursing, nursing mother, how did the infant survive and all of that? But the desperation You know, the woman knew that, okay, the chances are slim, but she was just, I mean, a girl. She was a girl. She was just ready to, you know, it was so sad. And I felt that. I felt that part.
The book was, like you said, a necessity.
Yeah, it is.
But
it is.
It's a bit much at once.
It is.
I think the part for me that I like was when Abed was, you know, building the house for Tandy.
Oh.
It felt so beautiful.
It is.
You know, post-independence, we're now free.
We're now free.
We can go into places we could never go before. I can build my, I don't think they were married at that point, but I can build my partner a house. And he was so excited about it. And you know, him and the carpenter, the person, the bricklayer, are having a conversation and you know, they're making jokes. And in that moment, I felt the beauty. I felt like the possibilities. I felt his happiness and joy. And in the next moment,
everything just vanishes.
Has this book changed you in any way?
Oh my goodness, it has. It has. It reinforced, I mean, something I've always known, but it reinforced that sometimes good people do terrible stuff. You know, sometimes, you know, I mean, I always say I'm disappointed, but not surprised. Mm-hmm. So it's that something that it reminded me again, that sometimes people with the best of hearts do terrible, terrible stuff. And then look at Zamani, you know, and then look at Abednego. I couldn't justify raping his stepmom, as it were, and killing her, but also consider how he needed help. And they didn't, and they didn't do that. So there's that. So that's one thing that it just reminded me again that sometimes people, good people, do terrible stuff, you know. And you also look at families, how families are structured. A lot of times there's so much, particularly in this part of the world, we just don't talk, we just don't share. There's so much that is just.
Yeah, we don't. We just keep it quiet.
Just keep it quiet. So that was also something that.
Part of what this changed for me is like, I want to know more about my history.
Yeah.
There is so much more that I don't know, but I do want to know a lot more and document it maybe.
I agree. And it's very important that people have these conversations. It's very important that, you know, particularly even in Nigeria, there's just so much that has happened that, I mean, at some point, I guess history was taken out of the curriculum. Just so much that has happened that we just don't talk about.
Because that's also a thing that...
Yeah, it happened.
...that Novuyo mentions in this book, where she says, our history was rewritten, and the parts that they didn't want us to know, they took out.
They took out.
Or they edited it, so people don't know the full story. So you've spoken a lot about things you liked in this book. Was there anything you didn't like?
Well, first of all, I feel like I don't know what happened to Bikosi.
Okay.
And I also think this book should have come with Pam's trigger warning. I also think the book should have come with a trigger warning.
Oh gosh, don't judge a book by its cover.
That was one thing that I thought about, but how graphic the book is, and I just wish I could have been prepared.
I don't think none of us were prepared.
I just wish I was prepared for how graphic this book is. It's my goodness.
But you made it through. Thank you so much, Franklyne, for your time.
Thank you for having me.
This has been great.
It has.
If you have read House of Stone, drop your comment down below. We want to hear from you. Also, tell us what books we should read next, or tell us what books you are currently reading. Remember to use the hashtag BBC Africa Book Club and give this video a thumbs up.